Hello, a good day to everyone of us. So this is Jeremiah for EDUC211 Facilitating Learning. So now we're on our fifth lesson, which is student diversity. But before we discuss this topic, we are going to mention or discuss our learning objectives. So for our learning objectives, the first one is to identify the factors that entails student diversity in classroom. The second is to describe the different learning and thinking styles or thinking skill styles of the students. The third is to recognize their individual strengths and their multiple intelligence. And lastly, to describe the categories of exceptional learners. So what is diverse learning? So diverse learning is practically the primary objective of every school. To cater the diverse needs of learners regardless of their gender, age, race, religion, beliefs, and cultural backgrounds, etc. So diverse learning refers to the co-equal rights of every individual in the universal right of education. So teachers were subjected to different trainings to cater and handle diverse students with myriad of characteristics and needs. So all schools share the mission of helping every student to reach his or her full potential. However, teachers often find students in a class showing much diversity in their needs and interests. Students differ a lot in their motivation, prior knowledge, and skills learning styles because of their multiple intelligences, different interests and backgrounds. To tap each student's potential, the teachers needed to value students as an individual capable of making progress and embracing learning diversity is therefore an important direction in curriculum development. So what is diverse learning? So diverse learning includes a diverse learner, and a diverse learner is someone who number one, learns in different ways, has different learning styles, whether it's visual, tactile, or auditory. So he or she has the different strengths, interests, needs, and of course, language and background. So, and lastly, a diverse learner is someone who is not captured or by the traditional way of learning. So how student diversity enriches learning environment. So number one, so learner self-awareness is enhanced by diversity. Student diversity contribute to cognitive development. Student diversity also prepares learners for their roles as responsible members of the society. And lastly, student diversity can promote harmony. So tips on student diversity. So a teacher or a facilitator of learning should encourage learners to share their personal history and experiences, integrate learning experiences and activities, which promotes students' multicultural and cross-cultural experiences, to identify the pattern of unit that transcends group differences, communicate high expectations to students from all subgroups, use varied instructional method to accommodate student diversity. And another one is to vary the example that will be used to illustrate concepts in order to provide multiple contexts that are relevant to students with different backgrounds. Also to adapt the students with different background or learning styles that is appropriate to them. So diversify the methods of assessing and evaluating the student learning. So learning and thinking styles refers to the prepared way of learner to process information. So this describes a person's typical mode of thinking, remembering, or problem solving. Furthermore, these styles are considered to be bipolar dimension. Having a particular learning and thinking style simply denotes a tendency to behave in a certain manner. So personality dimension, which influences the attitudes, values, and social interactions. So there are three types of learners. So the first one is the auditory. Auditory learners makes up 30% of the population in the global world population. So if you're an auditory learner, information comes in the best way through your ears or through hearing. from speeches, presentations, or audiobooks. So you have a knack for foreign languages, you like to learn foreign languages, and benefit from study groups. So another type of learner is the visual. So visual learners makes up 65% of the global population. They tend to be neat and tidy, excellent spellers are very good in spelling, and quick to read charts. Visual learners also tend to be the fastest talkers. So kinesthetic makes up 5% of the population. So they are primarily male and love anything that is hands-on or practical or physical. These learners are often skilled athletes or musicians and are drawn to construction of projects, specifically science experiments, field trips, and other researches. So one of the most famous American educator psychologists is Howard Gardner. So he was considered to be the father of multiple intelligence that will be discussed after this one. So before we discuss the multiple intelligence, we are going to have his quotation. So for Howard Gardner, the biggest mistake of the past century in teaching has been to treat all students as if they were variants of the same individual, and thus to feel justified in teaching them all the same subjects as the same way. So what is Howard Gardner telling about us or to the students is about the so-called method of IQ system, which measures individual by using a common IQ test or an examination test. So for Howard Gardner, multiple intelligence or intelligence is an ability or a set of abilities that allows person to solve a problem or passion a product that is valued in one or more cultures or way or standard of learning. So, and every individual possesses multiple intelligence. So the theory of multiple intelligence proposed as the differentiation of human intelligence into specific modalities of intelligence rather than defining intelligence as a single or general ability. So multiple intelligence is a theory first posed or first idealized or conceptualized by, as mentioned a while ago, Harvard developmental psychologist Howard Gardner in 1983 that suggests human intelligence can be differentiated into 8 modalities and sometimes 9 modalities, which includes visual spatial intelligence, verbal linguistic, musical rhythmic, logical or mathematical, interpersonal, intrapersonal, naturalistic, and bodily kinesthetic. So it is debunking the usual thought that learning capabilities can be tested using a single IQ test system. So the main idea of multiple intelligence is that the people learn in variety of different ways. So multiple intelligence refers to a theory describing the different ways students learn and acquire information. So these multiple intelligences ranges from the use of words, numbers, pictures, and music to the importance of social interaction, introspection, physical movement, and being in tune with nature. Accordingly, an understanding which types of intelligence may or a student possesses that can help teachers adjust the learning styles and suggest certain career paths for these learners. So like the one being mentioned a while ago, so these are the 9 types of intelligences or skills that is related to multiple intelligence. So let us expound each. So the verbal linguistic, this is learning through spoken and written word. This intelligence always valued in the traditional classroom setting and in traditional assessment of intelligence and achievement. So naturalist, this type of learners learns through classifications and categories, and hierarchy. So the naturalist intelligence pick up on some subtle differences in meaning. So mathematical or logical intelligence, this kind of learner learns through reasoning and problem solving in this area has to do with logic obstructions, reasoning, numbers, and critical thinking. So another one is interpersonal intelligence. This is to communicate effectively and empathize or emphasize easily with others and maybe either leaders or followers. They often enjoy discussion and debate. So visual and spatial intelligence, they learn visually and organize ideas. Especially we see concepts in actions in order to process and understand them. The ability to see things in one's mind in planning to create a product or solve a problem. Another one is musical intelligence. Those with high musical intelligence learns through patterns, rhythms, and music. This includes not only auditory learning, but also identification of pattern through all the senses. The other one is the bodily kinesthetic. Those with this form of intelligence learn through interaction with one's environment. This intelligence is the domain of learners who are overly active. And the last one, actually, for the traditional or the first idea of Howard Gardner, or the first version of multiple intelligence of Howard Gardner, is the interpersonal intelligence. So this form of intelligence learns through feelings, values, and attitudes. So this is decisively or decidedly effective components of learning through which students place a value on what they learn and takes ownership of their learning. So for the revised version of multiple intelligence, they have added another type of intelligence, which is existential. So this is learning by seeing the big picture, why we are here, what is my role in the world. And this intelligence seeks connection to real understanding and application of new learning. So student diversity, for the ones with exceptionality. So one significant factor that highlights student diversity and individual differences is the presence of exceptionality. So this commonly refer to the learners with who are different in some way from the normal person or an average. So the terminology exceptional learning includes those with special needs related to cognitive abilities, behavior, social functioning, physical and sensory impairments, so as emotional disturbances and giftedness. So majority of these learners require a lot of understanding and patience, as well as the special education and related services if they're to reach their full potential of development. So the term learners with exceptionalities refers to the individuals whose physical behavior or cognitive performance is so different from the norm that additional services are required to meet the individual's needs. So disability and handicap are not interchangeable in terms. Disability refers to a functional limitation of a person that has interference in his physical or cognitive performance, such as the ADHD, whereas handicap refers to the limitation imposed upon a person with a disability by the society, such as lack of access for people in wheelchairs, etc. So labeling is an important issue with respect to the learners with exceptionalities. When students are identified with exceptionalities, stereotyping becomes easy, such as deaf students. However, people come before exceptionalities. Stereotyping may not be so automatic, such as students with a hearing of deficit or loss. So keep in mind the two rules with respect to labeling, which is people come before labels, and avoid making the persons equal the disability. So disability is a measurable impairment of limitation that interferes with a person's ability, for example, to walk, lift, hear or learn, while handicap is a disadvantage that occurs as a result of disability or impairment. So for the usual Omrod's psychological concepts, so he categorizes exceptionalities into four, which are the following. So specific cognitive or cognitive difficulties, social or emotional and behavioral difficulties, physical disabilities and health impairments, and lastly, sensory impairment. So let us expound those. So specific cognitive or the cognitive difficulties includes, number one, learning disability. So this cognitive disability is a nebulous term describing a person who has greater difficulty with mental tasks than the average person. So cognitive disabilities are by far the most common type of disability. Most cognitive disabilities are rooted in their innate characteristics, in most probably biology and physiology. So for example, so technically they're born with, or this, it is an inborn, an innate or natural disease or disorder that they have. So this requires a lot of reinforcement and proper teaching and handling of facilitation of learning. So the first one is dyslexia, or the difficulty in reading. So particularly in their calcula, or the difficult, and the other one is calcula, or the difficulty in number operations. And we also have the graphia, which is a difficulty in writing. So another types of cognitive difficulties is the so-called ADHD, or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. This is a brain disorder that affects how you pay attention, or these persons or these individuals have the difficulty to control their behavior. It happens in children and can go as far as those from the teenage group or age group, and can continue into adulthood. So ADHD is the most commonly diagnosed mental disorder in children. So another one is called as communication disorder. So they have problems or troubles in communicating with others. So he or she may not understand or make the sounds of speech. The child may also struggle with word choice or word order, or sentence structure. So this includes, or its types are, mixed receptive expressive language disorder. So this is where a child has a developmental delays and problems understanding spoken language and speaking. The expressive language disorder, so wherein a child has a developmental delays and problems speaking. So another one is speech sound disorder. So a child has a hard time expressing words, which is clearly past a certain age wherein he or she must know how to express his word or speak words or sounds utterly in his or her tongue. Another one is childhood onset fluency disorder, most commonly known as stuttering. So it starts in childhood and then can last throughout his or her life. So the last one is social communication disorder, wherein a child has a trouble with verbal and nonverbal communication that is not caused by thinking problems. So another type is what we call, or another subgroup is what we call the social and emotional behavioral difficulties. So this type of difficulties includes a person or a learner's inability or difficulty in holding back or controlling their emotions, so as their behavior. So one of its most common example is autism, or autism spectrum disorder in a wide range. So this refers to a broad range of condition characterized by the challenges with social skills, repetitive behaviors, speech and nonverbal communication. So autism is a developmental disorder characterized by difficulties with social interaction and communication, and by restrictive and repetitive behavior. So another one is ID, or intellectual disability, a term used when a person has a certain limitation in cognitive functioning and skills, so including communication, social and self-care skills. This limitation can cause a child to develop and learn more slowly or differently than a typical developing child. And lastly is the conduct disorder. It refers to a group of repetitive and persistent behavioral and emotional problems in youngsters, or those from the young age group. So most likely children and adolescents with this disorder have great difficulty following rules, respecting the rights of others, showing empathy, and behaving in a socially acceptable way. And we have physical disabilities and health impairments. So physical disabilities are those persons who are suffering or those that impair normal physical functioning. So they may be has a problem in the physiological manner, such as orthopedic, neuromotor, or musculoskeletal impairments. So health impairments are diseases, illnesses or conditions such as asthma, epilepsy that require special care or attention and may impair learning and normal functioning. So the most common example of this, most common examples of this physical disabilities are the following: cerebral palsy, spinal cord injury, amputation, multiple sclerosis, spina bifida, polio, rickettsia, musculoskeletal injuries such as back injury, arthritis, muscular dystrophy, and many more. So multiple disabilities means that a student has more than one serious disability, which may affect the mobility, behavior, emotion, or sensory ability. So some characteristics, challenges of individuals with severe multiple impairments are having a limited communication or speech impairment. So they also have a significant problem with physical mobility. So another subgroup is called sensory impairment. So it is when one of your senses, whether sight, hearing, smell, touch, or taste, and spatial awareness is no longer normal or not functioning well. So example, if you wear a glasses, you have a sight impairment. If you find it hard to hear or have a hearing aid, then you have a hearing impairment. So visual impairment is also known as vision impairment or vision loss. So it is a decreased ability to see to a degree that causes a problem. It is not fixable by usual means such as glasses. So some include those who have decreased ability to see because they don't have access to glasses or contact lenses. Then the other one is the hearing impairment. So so based on the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act or IDEA, so they define hearing impairment as an impairment in hearing, whether permanent or fluctuating, that adversely affects a child's educational performance but is not included under the definition of deafness. So how can we help those students with special needs? So these are the guidelines for handling learners with special needs. So number one, adapt and modify materials and procedures to address the special needs of each student. So break complex learning into simpler components, moving from the most concrete to abstract. So be aware of everything that happens in the classroom at all times. Monitor students for restlessness, frustrations, anxiety, or off-task behavior. So be ready to refocus and reassign students if necessary. So successful teachers handling a student with diverse background provide for and teach students about success on how they will achieve success. Provide guided or coach practice of what is being learned. Provide help in the organization of student learning. So has a proper merit system or the reward and reward approved and appropriate behavior, and then teach students the correct procedures for every function in class. So always remember that all students are expected to grow and progress or reach their full potential. So always remember to begin at their level, escalate consistently to allow them to develop, and offers all students tasks that are and look interesting, equally important, and engaging. So that ends our discussion. So before we leave, I will leave a quote. So every child is the elegant kind of flower, and all together they make this world a beautiful garden. So just like what is discussed a while ago, every student is unique and brilliant in their own. So we as facilitators are expected to facilitate them to reach their full potential. And for our list of references used, so that ends our discussion. So I'll see you again on our next